Okay, hello everyone who's come here. This is Dr. Kinger's here. Alicia is here. Rita is also here. You guys can come on because Dr. Kinger broke my big reveal where I wanted to bring everybody on together. Of course. Can you guys hear me?
If you guys
on the chat.
Yes, hi Neville.
Thing for some reason I can't seem to hear you guys, which is great. I know why. That's my fault.
Apparently, this is a very fussy system. This is the first time I'm doing a live streaming on YouTube, so I am nervous as hell. Hello everyone. Okay, first of all, I want to start off this thing. First of all, thank you so much for coming on board, all three. We have with us Dr. Kinger. Mr. Kinger, please raise your hand.
Hi.
This is my man. He is my therapist. He is the one of the three people in the world who have pulled me out of the gutter at a terrible time and has kept me alive and sane.
Neville, hyperbole.
No, please. He also has a sense of humor. He's also been referred to in my special as the person who wears the tie and yawns when I talk. This is the doctor with Dr. Naren. We also have Miss Preeta Basu. She is also here. She's a social psychologist and a cognitive behavioral therapist. What is a cognitive behavioral therapist?
I think cognitive behavioral therapist is a person who always works with your thinking.
Yeah.
Along with your behavior. So if you think you change your thinking patterns, you can change your behavior as well.
Okay. And also with that, we have Miss Alicia Shell, who is a clinical psychologist and a psychotherapist.
Hi guys.
Alicia was there when I was at Pit Bottom working with Mr. Kinger in his clinic. And she had seen me go walk out. And have I improved a lot in 4 years, Alicia?
Lots.
Lots. You have to say that. It's my life. I can kick you out. You don't have a choice. All right. First of all, I want to start off. So thank you so much, all three of you joining. I know it's a Sunday. It's the one day that you want to take a mental health break from all the crap that you listen to all through the week. But really, thank you so much for this.
Thank you very much for actually doing this. I think is the need of the hour. Actually, we should be thanking you. And I think everybody who's here should be actually thanking Neville, because I think he's really worked very hard. I don't think he slept. He's not shaved, all that. So, yeah.
Shave though is normal. If I shave people.
We don't think we would be able to put this up ourselves. So, thank you.
No, not at all. So, thank you. The other people I would like to thank is, I genuinely don't have a huge following. And so I put up a link and a few people shared it. We have about 520 questions across the board.
Wow. Okay.
And so I just want to, first of all, say that there's 520 questions. I don't expect everyone to be able to answer all 520 questions. This is not going to be an individual therapy session. Neither it is a broadcast of my therapy session. So what we have actually done, and I have worked with all three of them to sort of categorize and funnel the questions that we've got. People at OML, and there's a lot of people. There's Mehtab, there's Prashita, there's Akshay, there's Nas, there's a million people. Someone has turned on the YouTube stream in their own house also, which is great. Despite us doing a tech check to do this. So thank you. So we had so many questions, and all of these guys helped us put it together. Priyanka helped me with this link in the morning because I haven't slept till 5:30 in the morning. So thank you so much. I have friends to thank. There's Shibu and there's Shibu, and there's lots of other people that who sort of helped put this together. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to focus on the questions that help us get through the lockdown. I think that in this time, there are a lot of people who didn't even know they had anxiety. They had certain symptoms. People who were dealing with a lot of stuff that already existed in their lives, they just sort of, brushed it under the carpet. We currently have about 280 people on the live. So that's a decent number, I think. And what we really thought, what all of these symptoms are sort of getting exacerbated by this lockdown. And I think instead of trying to break down each question, we've obviously broken them up into these parameters and we're going to sort of go by them. But before that, I want to thank the people who've put out the questions, even though they've done it anonymously. One of the best things, and I know I'm rambling, I'm going to come to the experts really soon, just wait. One of the best things is somebody has written saying just typing this out has made me feel better. So it was kind of a journaling exercise. Some people have actually gone ahead and said that, just asking the questions means somebody's willing to listen to us and somebody's willing to help. So thank you for that. There's so many themes that overlap. There's so many questions. You know, 19-20 ka farak hai ya 15-20 ka farak hai, you know, kisi ka bhai hai to kisi ka behen hai, kisi ka maa hai to kisi ka baap hai, that kind of situation. The one thing is I'm not going to be talking about questions that deal with outside the quarantine. I am, however, going to, at the end of this live, give you a couple of numbers that people can talk to, set up. It's an NGO called Talk to Me. Naren's a big part of the organization. In fact, he has harrowed me for a logo. We'll also give you that organization number. You can have a conversation at the end. So let us begin by some things that people can do. So just tell me quick things, three tips that you can, you know, for everyday coping techniques that can help you get through this time, you know, just coping techniques. And this is not based on anything, just for normal people. And I say normal with air quotes.
So who would like to start? Can I start?
Yeah, please.
Sure.
Yeah, so Neville, one tip would be to divide your day into three parts, 8-8 hour thing. So 8 hours for sleep, 8 hours for doing some work, and 8 hours for recreation. So that's one tip, very simply put. So you divide your day according to that. Second tip would be to do things which you enjoy. So if you enjoy listening to music, you enjoy dancing, you enjoy playing games, and obviously either it's a video game or an indoor game, you can do that. That's the second part. Third, not lose connect with your friends and social circles. So keep in touch with people you care for, or keep in touch with people you really are close to. These are the three tips from me.
Okay.
Okay, I think, other three tips.
Okay, this is going to be chaotic.
The other three tips would be getting enough sunlight, because it's really, really important. It kind of enhances your mood and things like that. It's very important to get some sunlight in the day. Say, for example, if you're kind of sleeping late and waking up, get a time where you can kind of sit by your window and get some sunlight. Or if you have a facility where you can go for a walk within your building, obviously, where you can get some sunlight, that would work as well. Very, very important tip would be limiting social media intake. The kind of lockdown that we're in, it's kind of impossible to say that don't consume media, because everything is happening online. But again, keeping a check on the media intake that you have would be a really good tip. And the most important thing I feel is physical exercise and movement, because it can do wonders to your mood. So these are the three tips.
Great. Preeta?
I think most of my these are covered, but I think we must use this time to visualize and create the future. Take this opportunity to sit back and not lose hope, not lose purpose in our life. I think that's what we need to hold on to, and remember that this is going to end. It is not a crisis that will continue lifelong. It will come to an end. I think those are my tips.
Preeta, the thing is, like, you're talking to me, who, if these people all know, everybody in the comments is like, because they all know me. And I'm the least positive person on the planet. So to hope that this thing will end is difficult. But no, thank you. That's a great way to start. Is there things that you can do to manage? And I'm just sort of, you know, getting things, the general stuff up top before we delve into each category. We're here for a while. Thank you for that as well. But how do you manage like anger, temper, stress? Like, is there anything that you can do? Is it just going to a shelf for like 45 seconds, 1 minute? Like, how do you manage these three things that tend to shroud upon us? Also, I'm not being rude. I'm just looking at chats and questions and things like that. I'm listening to you fully intently. So shut up in the comments.
Okay, really important to kind of understand where the anger is coming from. For example, if someone you see is getting angry, it's important to know that anger is a secondary emotion. There's something behind anger which needs to be kind of checked. Say it's frustration or irritation or, loneliness. Anything that can come out as an acting out mechanism in terms of anger. Again, the person who's responding to anger can respond and not react. There's a difference between someone who responds to anger and someone who reacts. Those are the things I think we should keep in mind.
Neville, if I look at it, I think in India, we are told to, just suppress your anger. Gussa mat karo. So I think if anger is coming, I think let it come. That's my one take. the other is, I think, focus on, so it's an emotion. You cannot run away from it. You cannot say, okay, this shouldn't be the case or aisa nahi hona chahiye. What we need to understand is the trajectory of the anger and the intensity of the anger. We can have mild, moderate, severe anger. And sometimes, the level of frustration that each of us is going through in life varies from person to person. So there are some people who get more angry than others. Also, our frustration tolerance. So there are people who can handle frustration more easily vis-a-vis others. And those who handle frustration are able to cope up better. So these are individual aspects. I think it's okay to feel angry, but it's not okay to lash out, or it's not okay to be violent, or it's not okay to be abusive. So it's okay to be angry.
Okay.
Tips to challenge your anger is to
or be stress completely, or whatever.
Or stress or depression or anything. I think mindful strategies really helps. Focusing on an object, having a mantra, repeating a mantra, or having a space to yourself in a day to go and sit and say, this is my space, this is my headspace. I'm just not going to react or interact with anybody in the outside right now. So you sit down, meditate, work out. If you can take your anger out in working out, that's the best way to do it. If you are not the person who likes to work out, if you are a person who likes to do creative arts, draw, paint, listen to music, I think these are stress busters, anger busters, frustrations. Everything in a shell can be beat with these couple of tips.
Iska ek bahut bahut important ahem sawal hai ki how the hell do you get yourself to do any of this? Because I have tried to get this damn thing together for 3 months. How do you actually get up in the morning and say, I have to do this? So one tip that I have, which is a very pedantic tip, it's not educated, I'm not a doctor in any way, but I make lists, and I make lists with really stupid things on them. So I'll write like pay credit card bill. Even that will be on it, pay phone bill,
wash bartan,
so what that ends up doing is every time I scratch off something, it just, however small, it just looks like tune kuch to kaam kiya hai, however dumb that is. That's one way I look at it. But how do you get up in the morning and say, I have to get this done? Apart from kaam to hota rahega, and I'm going to come to that. But like, how do you do any of these other things? And now I'm going to start going Arnab. So just whoever wants to answer, because I've realized that if this happens, I'm not even going to get to the first section. So let's go.
So I think, Neville, I think
there is a question.
The question is basically, how do you get up and do something? How do you get out of the procrastination that exists in our lives?
Have you heard of automate something, as in put alarms on your phone, your smartphones?
Uska to snooze button hai na option.
Do not put the snooze button. I think this is what I'm trying to say is your technique is fantastic. This is time and again tested and works extremely well. So breaking everything down in small projects and reward yourself. I think, Neville, what you are not doing is rewarding yourself. The rewarding yourself is a very important thing today. If you are a procrastinator, if you are not productive, even the smallest of bartan karna hai can be rewarded. You must reward yourself. सो हाउएवर यू वांट टू
रिमोट फिर मैं मोटा हो जाएगा आइसक्रीम टब खा के
चलेगा वर्कआउट करना है एंगर और फ्रस्ट्रेशन निकालने के लिए इट विल गेट बैलेंस्ड
Okay, I'm gonna keep moving. I've got a lot of generic questions which I'm going to come back to, like how to work from home and that sort of balance. And there's one interesting thing I have is there's a lot of people during this time that are feeling loneliness. There are people who are claustrophobic. There are people who are losing their diets, where you know, to them dieting was a very important thing. So there are people who have, as Naren has pointed out to me several times, एक रियल सेल्फ है और एक आइडियलाइज्ड सेल्फ है जितना गैप कम रहेगा उतना अमेजिंग रहेगा आदमी खुशी सो द थिंग हियर इज इफ यू लुक एट दिस एंड आई एम नॉट टॉकिंग अबाउट द जनरल प्रेशर ऑफ बीइंग न्यूली प्रोडक्टिव थिंग्स दैट यू वर डूइंग ऑलवेज वेदर इट वाज डाइटिंग वेदर इट वाज समथिंग दैट गेव यू हैप्पीनेस दैट हैज बीन टेकन अवे फ्रॉम यू वेदर इट वाज वर्किंग आउट और समथिंग लाइक दैट एंड देन आई एम क्लॉस्ट्रोफोबिक एंड अबव ऑल ऑफ दैट आई एम ऑल्सो वरीड अबाउट other situations, right? So the bigger question and concern is, what is it that I should do to make this feel great? Like, how do I compensate for that? And as an introvert who doesn't talk to someone, I'm further in my shell now.
Yeah, so Neville, I can just share an example. A client of mine who lives with a roommate, he said ki my roommate doesn't come out for 16 hours at a stretch and he only comes out for lunch, dinner and you know, just 5 minutes to have a chat. And though I'm living with a roommate, I'm feeling extremely lonely. So this need to connect is a very basic human need. So one thing we need to really understand is that people have to make extra attempts to connect. So it can be a video call, it can be a phone call, it can be a group call. Obviously, like we are using Zoom, so it can be a Zoom call where you can connect with 20 people. Second thing is there's a lot of games which are now available on the net. So you can start playing some games with your friends. So it's not that you're alone. So you can have 10, 15 group of, it could be family members, it could be friends, and you get along and have a chat or have a game session. Third could be connect with your neighbors. The lockout is not preventing you from reaching out to your neighbors and people in your building. Right. So normally we shun our neighbors. We're busy with our schedules and we don't meet or talk to anybody. And this is a great opportunity to probably connect with those people, same people. Many buildings have this thing where in the evening, you know, some ladies come down and they sit in the garden or whatever and they chat, or they go to the terrace and they take a walk together. So I think if you really look at it, my strategy is that we have to adapt to the times. You cannot say, okay, I want to do the same thing the way I've done it earlier in my life. So as the times are changing, you have to change. You have no choice but to change.
Why are you giving me my therapy session right now?
I would like to add over here.
Yes, Alisa.
Like he said, you have to adapt and you have to change. Well, when we have to adapt and change, we can also keep the change as close to as it was before. Right? That would help. Like, okay, it's not a stark difference in what it was. Like, for example, I was working out every day and now I'm not working out every day. That would be a big thing kind of to manage. So working out every day could be shifted to working out every day online. Or doing workouts three times in a week or something like that, right? From home. So again, adapting to change, but in a way that it is kind of close to how it was before. There are many people where we can't have this expectation that it has to be close to how it was. For them, it's like a proper new routine again.
Okay, I was surprised that we would get 20 people on this chat, on this live. We have about 400 people. So it's nice. Okay, I'm gonna come back to the generic section. I'm gonna now start moving into the first section, which I think a lot of people have. There are a lot of questions around family. There's questions about anxiety, depression, family, loneliness, self-worth, all of these things. So here's how I wanna start talking about. So the first sort of thing is stress is causing a lot of fights. And because people are, you know, in the same house the whole time, really small things start to blow out of proportion on a regular basis. You're stuck with each other with nowhere to go. How do you cope with something as basic as this? I'm going to come to the more complicated ones, but how do you cope with something as basic as this?
Anyone
whoever,
would like to answer?
Whoever, go.
Okay, so I would look at it as a fight usually doesn't become a fight just instantaneously. It definitely has to start from a discussion which got escalated, and then it blows into a fight. So if we can have the strategies and the mechanisms of how a discussion could remain a healthy discussion, I think that would help. Again, a healthy discussion would be giving someone else a chance to talk, express how they feel, kind of try to understand that. And then when it's your time to respond, you respond. I think if that's the kind of discussion outline that we maintain, I don't think so it will convert into a fight. Yes, emotions are very tricky, and sometimes something might trigger you at that point in time. If you feel that is happening, it's important to take a time out, right? If you feel it's getting too overpowering to you, you will respond in a negative manner right now. It's better to leave that situation and come back to it and attend it after, say, 10, 15 minutes when you're calm.
Haan, but jab dusra person और भी चिल्ला रहा है मुंह पे, तो लाइक व्हाट डू यू जस्ट गो एंड स्लैम द डोर? लाइक
नो, यू डोंट स्लैम द डोर. नो, यू डोंट स्लैम द डोर.
Shut it while they are calling you shit.
You don't slam the door. You definitely assert boundaries that I'm not ready to have this discussion right now, and I will be leaving for some time, and I will come and attend back to you. I will definitely come back and address this.
Okay.
So boundary setting.
So I think you want to say something. Neville, I feel every family has dynamics, and the dynamics of the family, it depends on the status of people in the family. So normally the father is the head, or the mother is more powerful, and you know, the kids, again, there are dynamics in relationships. So typically these dynamics play a very important role, and at such time when people are in close proximity, they will end up really playing out in more intense fashion than they otherwise would. So we need to understand these family dynamics, first of all. So there may be a favorite child, and there may be an unfavorite child, or a non-loved child. In
breaking 50% of the siblings' hearts world over. Dr. Naren.
But you need to understand.
Naren OP in the chat. Guys, I'm going to do a Tanmay Bhatt and say Naren OP in the chat because of this real thing. Let's go.
So I think the child who's not feeling loved or whatever has to look at what is it that the child who's loved is doing, and maybe imitate for some time, and it may translate into that. That's one part. The other part over here is that I think what Alisha was saying is that you know, how you have team meetings in the morning, you know, you reach a company and everybody sits together for 10 minutes and has a chat, and you decide what's the workflow for the day going to be, or what are we going to achieve at the end of the day, or who's doing his job and who's not doing his job. So similarly, maybe there can be meetings in the morning or once a week or whatever, and the workflow can pan out. So the anger or throwing things or really rage is not an outcome. I think we need to look at how we can have better communication skills. And the same applies on a day-to-day basis.
Which would be interesting if... it's an interesting segue. And so, Preeta, tell me this. Like, what basis what Dr. Kinger, what Naren was saying right now, if you look at the latent family dysfunctionality, it's in the face now. It's always right. been there. It's always been there. We ignored it because I had college to go to. I had Mithi Bhai ka sandwich to eat. And I had
Jain ka kheema
power to eat. Yeah, or I went and played badminton, right? Or my friend went for a cigarette. But whatever your coping mechanism was, you had the option to do it. Now that latent dysfunctionality is so much in the face, people are realizing it like now because they're always around fam. I'm just going to quote one question which sort of encapsulates this. It says, just realized how dysfunctional my family is. Didn't realize the extent of it till we started living together. I'm assuming he or she means during the lockdown. Till we start living together. How do I get through this without losing my mind? Tried speaking to my parents, confronting them about the issues, but they don't respond well. And this is coming back to the point we were talking about earlier, which is
correct.
The kids today have the vocabulary to say toxic, you are affecting right. me adversely, things like that. But maabaap to dheet hai na. Unko to, they don't have this vocabulary. So therefore, if this was the case, that latent, how do you deal with this?
So, Naveel, you know, we have lots of vocabulary. Like we were talking about this earlier too, that we are bold enough to say, "Arey, ye toxic hai, ye abusive hai, ye phalana dhimka, ye vagera vagera hai." Theek hai. But we have to be very patient at this time. We have to embrace everything that is happening around us. You know, a simple sorry, thank you, can be very, very crucial at this point. Your father may be screaming at you, and you know it may not be your fault. But at that point, just saying sorry and disengaging from that conversation and walking out will end that continuous barrage of that abuse. So, you know, you are not giving power to the person who's angry at you, because you have shut the conversation right there. You say sorry and disengage and walk away into your room, into your space, into wherever you want to. When things calm down, I think that is the best time to sit and talk. If it is a sensible parent, would like to listen to it. Otherwise, I think there are better ways in the outside world where you can, you know, help yourself with.
Hmm. But basically, apne ego ko ek pill mein dal ke, glass mein dal ke nigal lo is the solution.
Abhi ke liye.
Abhi ke liye.
Tum ego ghar se nahi bahar ja sakte ho.
Correct. I agree. Okay. What about the trypophobia, claustrophobia? Too many people having this. There are people who suffer from this. And I'm coming to a slightly more specific thing now. People who suffer from this or people who don't even understand that it may not even be claustrophobia. It may just be, I can't have people around me all the time, right? How do you create space for yourself emotionally? Not physically, because it's not possible, but emotionally, how do you create space for yourself?
A very good option to creating space emotionally is the whole idea of seeking online therapy. I think that
charger gir gaya, main leke aa raha. Aap baat karte raho.
Okay. Very good space to kind of cater yourself emotionally is online therapy. There are many platforms where people are conducting therapy sessions or even seminars that you can access. I think that's a good space where the venting can happen. If that is not a criteria, if that is not available to you, or maybe there are affordability issues and things like that, there are certain hobbies that each one enjoys doing, like something as basic as creating some art. That can be a good venting tool or like a tool that can, you know, help release some emotions, because there's a lot of research behind color therapy and art therapy. I think those are the tools that we can pick at this time.
Okay. Mera to West Wing hai. Main 15 baar dekh chuka hai. Main 16 baar chalu kar diya. Main season 3 episode 4 pe hai already. To mera emotional coping ye hai. 14 years I have watched it 15 times. I have now on my 16th run. But okay. So find something that you sort of like. How do you deal with somebody who you can't get along with, or you can't stand in your family, or whether it's a roommate or a flatmate? How do you deal with? And they're going to be there 24/7. They could be in the family. It could be your father. It could be your child. It could be your brother, sibling, friend, flatmate, roommate. Naren, how do you you've kept quiet for a while, so let's drop a truth bomb.
No. I think ultimately my fundamental thing is everything is playing out in your head. So if you sort out your head, a lot of things are going to, you know, sort themselves out.
Truth bomb.
So if you really
basically mera hi galti hai.
Truth bomb.
What I'm trying to say, Neville, when you say ke I cannot tolerate somebody, it becomes your issue. So you will have to really deal with it. The other person may not have such strong issues with you. So you have to come to terms with that. That's number one. The other is, if you understand what about this person are specifics which I dislike, you can have a chat on that and say ke bhai savere mein 6 baje alarm mat bajaya karo, ya mere ko garam garam chai mat pilaya karo, ya gaali mat diya karo, whatever it is that you are having specific issues with. Thirdly, I think maybe you can try to get along. So one of the techniques we use in psychology is the reverse of what we do. So you hate somebody, you can keep hugging them and say I love you, and
right,
you'll reach a point where if you don't at least love them, you at least neutralize your feelings towards.
But please don't do that, guys. He's not advising you to do that. That was, please understand, that was his analogy. It was, don't do it without consent. Please, guys, behave.
I I think what Naren is trying to say over here is that, you know, we need to distort the severity of the situation. Mujhe wo achha hi nahi lagta hai. Face it. Kyun nahi achha lagta hai? What is it about this person or what you cannot control about this person that you don't like? It's here,
the
right?
Three of you are going to convince every single one of the people who are watching to not go to therapy because you all are all making it our fault. Okay? This is not fair. हमारी गलती नहीं है, सब बाकी सब की गलती है. That is how we have to look at life. This whole like introspect or
things you can control versus you can't.
Oh, yeah. Psychology 101 and all. Don't give me. Okay, I have to do something because everybody on the chat wants me to do this. So guys, here's a marker. Okay. I'm sniffing a marker. Now shut the fuck up in the chats, okay? Because I did it in one podcast by mistake. So now everybody wants me to just do this all the time. Okay. There's people who are away from home, away from family. They are stuck away from home. They have anxiety about not being able to be close to family. They also have anticipatory anxiety. Ki it kab khatam hoga? Kaise shuru, matlab, how do I meet my family? All of that. They're also studying in another city, which means there's complications of you know, mera exam kab aayega, mera exam kab nahi aayega, that kind of realities. And then over and above that, there's friends who sort of are able to meet their family, talk to their family and things like that. How do you cope with this inability to be away from family, whether you like them or dislike them in this matter? I think family is family. For 95% of the people, I can't generalize. So what do you do in this case? Like just talking to them is not helping my anxiety. What do I do?
I think, Navil, you'll be surprised at this point that these people who are talking about all, I have read this one post where the person says that, you know, he's away from home, lonely, no parents, no friends, no counselors. I think abroad at this point, specifically at these unprecedented times, school counselors, like if you're studying in a college or a school, you can reach out to them and they are not going to charge you for being talking to you. So start at least with that, reach out. I think the only way you can beat your loneliness is to reaching out. Pick up the phone, like an old-fashioned way, pick up the phone and talk to somebody, you know. You'll be shocked that everybody at this point is feeling this loneliness, this separation, this anxiety, this fear of when is this going to end, this uncertainty. So you're not alone. You just do the old-fashioned way. Pick up the phone, talk to somebody, force yourself, push yourself to interact with either colleagues, either friends, or either, you know, clubs, groups. Communities, go out, pay it forward. There are communities which need volunteers, your help. You will make friends that way. This is what I would say.
Can I share one example? For example, in Bombay, there's a group I know which is giving food to 200,000 people, homeless people, or people who are stuck, or tribals, or people, you know, truck drivers who are stuck and things like that. Now, this is a volunteer-based activity in the sense that there were volunteers. They are not paid for. People went and helped cooking and things like that, and serving and things like that. Now, obviously, they needed special police passes, etc. So they kind of used their time for that, and they felt a sense of bond and the community connected. So that's one part of it. The other thing, look at it this way, that today you have smartphones, you have your laptops, you have Wi-Fi. I mean, in these times, communication actually and getting in touch with people has become so much easier than it was, say, 20 years back. Now, in this kind of a scenario where you have these facilities, the question of using those facilities. The third is, you may call and somebody may be busy. So it doesn't mean that they don't want to talk to you, or if they don't answer your call, it doesn't mean that they are not interested. It's just maybe that they may be connected, or they may be caught up with some other stuff. And people's sleep schedules have gone haywire. So there are people who are waking up at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. So if you call him between 10 and 2, he's not going to answer your phone, right? So it doesn't mean that they don't want to talk to you. Just as an example, about 40 people have just sent me messages, I hope you're okay. Now, these are random people whom I have not spoken to maybe for 2 years. So I think it's a question of reaching out and actually responding. That's what I think.
I think that's very correct. Checking in on each other at this time is very, very important. But again, I say that even if you don't check in because you're feeling very low, that is also okay. So whatever works for you at this time works for you. And the other thing that you said, Neville, was, yes, I'm connecting with my family, but that's not helping me. Right. So the connect and everything is there, but it's not helping me. I think it's time to think about a way in which you can be kind of involved in what you do together. Say, for example, someone's kind of playing the same game online at the same time. That is called emotional involvement. Okay, we're doing something similar together. Or nowadays, there is a great feature on Netflix Party, which has come up. You can kind of stream movies together and see it. Again, that is engagement and involvement. I think that is something that we're missing.
But what if you're like me, friendless? What if you're like me and everybody hates me and I have to do it on... I'm kidding.
Three of us are always
as
there for you.
As soon as the lockdown is over, you need to go and make a few friends.
Again, Naren OP, guys. Naren OP, of course, the man has to do this. Will not. So that's an interesting point. But now, which moves me into one thing, and I already know Naren's answer for this, but I'm just. What about digital addiction, digital dependency? What's ending up happening is a lot of fam and a lot of friends and a lot of people like are, you know, they're only connecting because kisi ko kaam hai. तो वो पूरा दिन मीटिंग्स कर रहा है या कर रही है एंड देन देयर इज समबडी एल्स हु हैज यू नो असाइनमेंट्स टू डू डिफरेंट फंक्शनिंग टाइम्स लाइक आई एम अ आई फंक्शन ड्यूरिंग द नाइट आई फंक्शन ड्यूरिंग द डे सो यू कम टुगेदर वंस इन द डे एंड इट कुड बी फॉर अ मील एंड ड्यूरिंग दैट मील यू विल वॉच समथिंग टुगेदर सो यू आर नॉट कम्युनिकेटिंग एज अ फैमिली यू आर स्टिल नॉट एंड आई एम नॉट सेइंग दैट दैट्स व्हाट यू हैव टू डू बट दिस डिजिटल डिपेंडेंसी isn't the addiction how do you do that like you know what Naren had once told me as a truth bomb saying that before you go to sleep no 30 minutes before you go to sleep put your phone in the hall main bola pagal hai kya
lock it in a drawer
ye kya hai ye who does this you're mad or what nobody can do this okay like normal people can't do all this he said take your phone put it in the hall but then he started there at the extreme and he sort of came down to saying okay put it on D&D. It's still there and allow the 2-3 people that you need in your life to call you. Only those people will call you and you know that they're not going to call you at 4 in the morning and 3 in the morning. So, because I was constantly getting anxious about kaam aa raha hai, ye ho raha hai, wo ho raha hai, and there's various parts of my life. So, digital dependency, how does that affecting it adversely? Dependency is okay, I guess, but is addiction, how do you get out of the addiction. How do you stop yourself from doing it? Because everybody is saying, "Toh kya karo na, dekho na, do what works for you." Dog, Naren, go, bajao me, let's go.
No, so I think so a lot of us are using the phone or the internet as an escape mechanism. Okay, so whereby we don't really connect with other human beings around us. So my whole focus has always been that. You are lonely or you feel friendless because you're not connecting to the people around you. So actually it's a quid pro quo. So if you change your strategy, the results will be different. That's one part of it. The second thing is when you are on the phone and somebody's talking to you or somebody's trying to communicate with you and you keep looking down and you're doing that, it's extremely disrespectful to the other person. It seems that you're actually not interested in having a relationship.
Doc, this is an entire 30-minute session with you sometimes, okay?
Subconsciously, you're sending the message that I don't care for this relationship. So that's the second part of it. Really speaking, we need to have a limit. And the classic thumb rule says that not more than 10, 12 hours a week. This is what is prescribed for children, okay? So you watch back-to-back Netflix shows from 10 in the morning to 6, I mean 10 in the night to 6 in the morning, you finished your weekly quota. The remaining 6 days, you don't do anything. So I think thumb rules have to be applied somewhere.
Instead of connecting to the digital world, sometimes it is good to connect to the real world also. It's not you or I am also very addicted to my phone. I want my phone all the time. I'm carrying it in my back pocket. I'm walking around. You know, every 2 minutes, I'm checking that. I'm checking my watch. And I'm addicted to it. But the only way to stop doing that is replacing it with something that you like to do. I love Instagram, but I like to even bake, cook, or, you know, go for a walk or do exercise or do something else. So, you know, that balance has to come in. You can schedule yourself. You can tell yourself, "Haan, ek ghanta dekh liya, abhi ek ghanta kuch aur karenge, fir I'll come back to it." And that is how you slowly get yourself off it.
That's Alisha, you try all those timers and all over, because the timer also gives you an option to unlock.
Yeah, so I was just going to come to that there are some tips and tricks to kind of, you know, condition your brain to realize that, okay, this is how much of social media you've been using, or this is how much you've been using on your phone. So there are certain apps on the Play Store which are very accessible, and they will give you a real time track. Like, you've used WhatsApp for 10 hours in a day, you've used Instagram for 15 hours in a day, like, it will give you an update. And that will be, I think, a hitting factor where you'll be like, okay, this is how much I have been using my phone, and this is the kind of screen time I have. First, the awareness will be built immediately with that. Again, what Narendra sir was also saying, like, surroundings, you have to kind of declutter and kind of keep it very, so that there are less distractions, right? Again, the pop-up of the messages that comes, you can kind of put that off. You don't have to see the blue light time and again, because that is kind of an impulse reaction. You want to go and check your phone, right? So basic things like those, I think, could help.
Okay.
But there guys, is a contrary view to this. So there are times where, suppose I'm not replied to a message for, say, 1 hour or 1.5 hour, people get agitated. They expect that moment they send a message to you, that you, they actually, okay, udhar kuch nahi khali kar raha hai, wo baitha hai.
Victory! He's finally blaming somebody else. Guys, he is finally doing it. This is unbelievable. 4 years I have waited for him to say this. It's somebody else's fault.
No. So the point here is, it's actually not only that you are digitally addicted, but you're expecting the other guy to be also digitally addicted.
I'm just
immediate gratification.
He's just hammering you. That's all very, he's doing.
Yeah, this is a session for me. Okay, two or three more questions. So family fights are seeming to exacerbate people's anxiety. How do they cope? And then parents being angry or losing their temper amongst themselves is suddenly becoming is affecting me. Because they involve me into their fights. They make me pick sides, or, you know, and it's really weird that this is how they're feeling, saying that I understand that two adults can have a differing point of view in a situation like this. They will think they love each other, no? But they're fighting. They shouldn't be together. Ye 10 saal pehle sochna chahiye tha. But the point is, they're fighting. This is affecting me. And because they're making me pick sides, and I want to just stay away. How do you cope with something like that? Like, stressful situations like that, where it's either anger or it's just fights in the family.
Okay, I'll answer this. This is kind of connected to another part, but I'll answer the basic question that you asked, Neville. You said that how can a child take care of themselves, or a teenager, or an adult take care of themselves, and parents are asking them to choose sides or making them a part of the whole fight. Again, here asserting boundaries is very important.
Sorry, Alisha, I don't want to interrupt you, but I've just found out that, hey guys, if you're watching this and you're commenting and stuff like that, can you just like the stream? Because if apparently you like it, YouTube pushes it up. And at 7:30, we are going to be taken away by Farhan Akhtar and Aamir Khan and A.R. Rahman and everybody on Facebook. So till then, just like the stream. So if you up like it, it works. Sorry, Alisha, please continue. I just wanted to promote.
No problem at all. Yeah. So asserting your boundaries that, yes, I think you're like expecting me right now to kind of be a part of this conversation, but I choose not to. And when you're choosing not to, you kind of put yourself back that I don't want to be a part of it. Again, this comes from a different space for everybody. There are some kids who think that we're obligated to our parents. We have to listen to them. You know,
but
that
there's
kind
also
of
a reverse to that, Alisha, which is that parents make you feel like you are obligated.
Yes, you are the problem. Yes. You are the problem. Yeah.
Parents make you feel that you are obligated.
Do you think ma baap hona hi nahi chahiye meri tarah? Is that the best situation?
No, that's not what I'm saying.
Okay.
But yeah, the obligation part, I think it comes from various factors of where you're coming from, which space you're coming from. Are you looking up to your parents as authority figures? Are you looking at them as I have an obligation to fulfill? Or is it coming from a space of, okay, I want to help them out, but I will ask them, okay, how am I supposed to help you out? And things like
okay.
that.
Okay, but what do you do when they're making you pick sides?
Neville, can I say something here?
Yes,
so the problem, I think here, the problem here is that what parents fail to understand is that the kid loves both the parents equally. I mean, he's equally connected. I mean, he may not have the same amount of emotional connect, but to them, you are equally important. So when you ask a kid to take sides, it's becomes emotionally disturbing for the child. So the problem here is that parents will have to accept that our problems have to be resolved amongst ourselves. And the child has to be definitely kept out of it. And if they are not doing that, then as Alisha just said, it's up to the kid to say, "Okay, dad and mom, you all have to resolve this. I cannot take sides because I love both of you."
But 14 साल का बच्चा ये बोलेगा तो अगला दिन खाने में उसको करेला ही मिलेगा ना?
The 14, I think the tape that from childhood we've been fed, the constant tape that you know you. Because of you, you know, we are in this marriage. If you wouldn't have been there, you know, we would have divorced. Always remember, you are not the problem. They are the adults who are not able to deal with their problem and blaming it on you.
Yeah, anti-kinger hai. Yeah, amazing hai. You are not the problem, guys. Baki sab duniya mein problem.
Yeah, parents also need to work on their communication skills, because if they're going to give two messages to the same child, they're going to be like, take my side. The child is going to be left confused. He will not know, she will not know what to do, and this will go on for a really long time, and then the whole partiality and everything starts.
Why does the parent need a referee? I mean, they don't need a referee. Bash each other up and it's okay.
Guys, he does not mean that. Please, he talks like me. He does not mean it. Please don't bash anybody. I'm coming to a slightly more serious aspect of this. All of this has been serious, but I think this is genuinely worrisome for a lot of people. There's a lot of people who've faced abuse, whether it's physical, sexual, emotional. And they're victims of abuse. And there's two cases. One is they're still going through it. And now it's just increased because of the situation. And then there is another section of people who were very conveniently, they were living in a joint family, but what they were able to do is, leave home at 10 in the morning and come back at 10 in the night and never have to face, their perpetrator. But now they are living with the person who has abused them. And there's two types of this. So one is, let's first deal with how do you live with someone who has abused you? And then let's do the second one, because the second one has a solution that is slightly easier. It's tough to do, but it's slightly easier. Yeah.
Naren, you want to go?
So Neville, I think it's a very, very serious issue that you brought over here. And I can understand that it's extremely difficult because of various circumstances. You may be thrown into a situation where you have to deal with a person who's abusive sexually or in other ways. I think one of the things would be to have a person you can talk to about this, because obviously you cannot just blow it open in the family, because there's guilt, there's shame, there's so many other mixed emotions. So many times, actually, instead of grappling with these emotions on your own, I think it's a good idea to reach out to some kind of a therapist. And lot of, just to share with you, you are in the room, so that you don't have the privacy. Maybe you need to go out and, have a conversation or something. That's one part of it. I also think that the real situation comes because there's also the fear of abuse happening again. So it's not just anger, but there's also the anxiety that, I'm thrown in this situation where the situation may. So to ensure that those things don't happen is the key over here.
And what about, so the reason you're saying this, where, you know, I just want to clarify that line. When you say that you don't want to blow it up in the family because there's shame, there's anger, there's a lot of things associated with it. This is something that they need to deal with in therapy. This is what we're talking about right now, is about how to, whether you've dealt with it or whether you are seeing currently a therapist or not seeing a therapist, or you will now because you've lived with this for the last 21, 30 days. And so it's obviously taking a toll on you. This is for what you should do right now. We understand that family members, you yourself have shame associated with it. Should we have it? Nobody's passing a judgment on that. I think you need, I mean, we believe that you should see a therapist for that, to sort of get over these things. But right now, I think what Naren was saying makes sense. What if you are living with someone who is currently abusing you, and it's just gotten worse? How do you get the courage to call the cops? Because again, there is shame, there is guilt, there is all of that associated with it. Whether it is for emotional abuse in this country, it's such a fine line. Parents say to daatna hi hai, is an abuse, is a thing that makes sense, right? But what about if someone's physically or emotionally or sexually abusing you right now? What do you do?
I think the first thing is you have to ask for help. You have to save yourself first. That is the first response. You please save yourself first, and then whatever that you can do behind that, you do all of it. But save yourself first from that situation by kind of creating awareness that this is happening with me, and I want to tell you about it. There are many people who kind of don't express this. They feel like if I tell somebody that someone has abused me, it's going to become about me, or I'm going to be in the bad light and things like that. So that's the stigma that needs to break, where the person is free to go and ask for help. So for example, in a lockdown situation, if the abuser is just at home, you can kind of take help from your neighbors. Call them and tell them that this has been happening with me, or any authority figure who would be there to help you out. And then if nothing works out for you, the last resort is law and order.
Neville, I'm seeing about 3 clients currently who were sexually abused. They are not at home, they are alone, but the very fact that they're locked in, or they're just with a roommate and they're alone, all the whole impact of the abuse is coming to them, and they're feeling more and more suicidal. So when I was saying that you need to reach out to a therapist, I particularly had those cases in mind where actually, rather than feeling all alone, feeling isolated, and remembering your own trauma, it's better that you went out. And there are a lot of other options which are available in terms of you may be getting panic attacks, or you may be feeling extreme, you're crying nonstop, or whatever, you're not getting sleep. So all these symptoms of extreme anxiety and extreme depression needs to be dealt with. That's why I said, you were talking in the context of living in the family. I'm also looking at, there are a lot of people who are living alone. But yeah, the fact that they have nothing else to do, these things, these flashbacks keep coming to them. And I think they are extremely traumatizing for them.
Okay. So Kavin, I'm going
like
to come
to add one last thing on this is, I know at this point, a lot of people need courage. And building your own self-esteem before you actually can reach out to somebody is a key, because you need that courage. You need to build the courage to pick up the phone and call the cops, or call an NGO and say that this is what is happening to me, is to build that inner circle, the inner trust around yourself, your friends, the person you can trust, your loved one, your significant other. I mean, it could be anybody. It could be a neighbor. And again, to add to the point that we need to build ourselves to be stronger at this point, so we can reach out and make that phone call or confront this person that enough is enough. You know, I am not the problem. This is not me. It's the abuser who is the bully, or the abuser, or whoever that person is.
And the abuser is actually playing on your fear, and that you'll not do it. So the moment you state it that, I'm going to possibly do
stop.
This,
he or she
many
will
of
stop.
Them will stop and back off. So you have to overcome your fear of the
courage.
I need to wrap this up quickly. So I'm just going to come to one thing, which is, a lot of family members don't believe that you need therapy. I mean, Doc, you know this. In 2014, I was a guy who would laugh at anybody who wanted therapy. I was a guy who would be like, "Arey, kya hai? Vilpari nahi hai isko? Kya theek to apne aap?" Like, I was that guy. Like, I didn't think that people who went to it were bad human beings. I just think that they were weak human beings. That's how I did it. And I'm the biggest victim of that mistake, because if you see me in the last 4 years, I've gone through medication with a serious crisis of confidence, saying, "Yaar, ye to main hack hi niklega," with a major imposter syndrome. I actually believe that the anxiety is what makes me work better, which was such a stupid thing to think of at that point. Don't laugh, Naren. I know what you're thinking. Abhi bhi kar raha. But the thing is, how do you convince a folk or a fam member saying that you need to see a therapist, and there's nothing wrong with seeing that therapist? How do you even approach or reproach that conversation at all?
So I'll wait till they answer. Let me see what they
say. Achha, isme, ye kya, aap, iska bhi
pariksha. Rita, you want to go first this time?
I would like them to give their inputs.
I think, Navil, I have a lot of, now these people who are actually reaching out to you are also people who can reach out to people like us. Let me clear this out, that not every therapist is going to charge you because you can pay. Okay, we do a lot of pro bono work also. If you think that your parents are not going to listen to you and not going to pay for your sessions and you need therapy, please do approach therapists. A lot of therapists, people like us, would do pro bono work. We will help you out without charging any fees. That's one. Number two is, you cannot change anybody's thought processes. But going to a doctor in India, like whatever the doctor says, so ask your general physician, your GP or somebody, to approach your parents and say, maybe your son or daughter may need somebody like this to help you, a therapist to help him in this situation of anxiety. That's number two. This is, I think, is just a beginning. I would like my other colleagues to, add to this.
Mere ko often banna pada therapy jane ke liye. Sirf bol rahe main.
So I want to say a few things here, Neville. One is, so the funny part is, a lot of our clients are referred to us by other clients, which means that you'll send your friend only when you have benefited from it. So one of the sales pitch, according to me, is that, you should listen to your friends, talk to your friends, and ask them whether you should. So don't just go by parents' opinion.
Correct. Aadha comedy fraternity Naren ke paas jata. No.
Trusted resources. Okay.
No, that's one part. The other thing, Neville, is so you shouldn't judge on anything before you tried it. So if you think it works or doesn't work, I'm not saying you have an opinion on it. You go for it, you see whether it works for you, and then take an informed choice or an informed opinion. The third part is, there are different kinds of therapists. So maybe one therapist may not work for you. You need to go to a second therapist or a third therapist. So that's one part of it. I think
the... Mera set hi bata do sabko.
No. What therapists basically are objective individuals who are trying to understand you, give you their undivided attention, and actually help you understand your own problems better. Now, they are not connected to you emotionally, or they are not part of your social circle. So you can go there and do whatever you want. Like, there are clients who will come and tell me, "I hate you." And I smile at them and I say, "Okay, you hate me." Now, dare you say this to your father, "I hate you"? It's not going to work, because you're going to live in his house. So I think the whole intent of therapy is to, first of all, get a safe space where you go and speak whatever is happening to you. And I think it is for you to explore your own inner world. I think therapy helps you to come to terms with your own inner world. That's why...
Correct. The amount of times you've reminded me about this.
Also, okay. To explain, Neville, I just want to add one thing. Also, to explain this to parents, I think, is what also your question was highlighting. If you kind of do like a small exercise with them and tell them, "Okay, I'm going to throw this pillow at you. And until I don't take the pillow back, you have to just listen to me for 1 hour."
What are you, in kindergarten, Alicia?
Yeah, if you have to listen to me for 1 hour, I am sure they're going to give some advice in the middle. I'm sure they're going to, nudge in the middle or tell you what to do. and explain you and reason it out and things like that. So you don't know which space they are coming from. You don't know where the child is coming from, what the child wants to talk about, whether the child is feeling accepted when they share that with you. So I think therapy is such a accepting space where it's a safe space for the person where they can talk about anything under the sun. So I think it's definitely healthy. And in fact, all the therapists also have to go to therapy. I will assert this because with the kind of difficult jobs that we have, at least once a month or once in 15 days, we do have to consult our peer group. And that's a part of therapy.
Yeah, therapyception.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Neville, you are doing our therapy right now, actually.
Correct.
Yeah.
Naren, I'm sending you a bill. Right now, I'm sending you a bill.
Done.
Okay. Sorry. I want to move to another. So there's like, okay, guys, there are way too many questions. And if you guys really like this, we will try to find a space once a month or something like that to be able to do this. I know they're really busy. I will talk to other therapists. There you go. That's what I said. I know that they're really busy and stuff like that, but I will try to talk to other therapists and try to get people. But I'm trying to get as many questions as I can that are about the lockdown and that are overall covering the majority fears. There's somebody who's talking about, just quickly, one last family one before I move into anxiety and depression. The two favorites, the Karan and Arjun, the Ram and Lakhan, the Sita or Gita of mental health, the two pillars of mental health. Before I talk about that, there's a lot of people who are, women are facing a weird sort of thing. In some cases, they have to do all the work. The work has quadrupled or pentupled and because of everybody being there. There you go. Abhi matha take liya usne. The thing is, and also getting people to understand choice. But there's another section. There's women who are going to give birth in a couple of months. There are women who've just given birth, who are going through postpartum. And surprisingly, there were about 40 odd questions that were about this. And which is why I bring it up, which is a considerable chunk. And you know, in some cases they're pregnant and they're just not able to leave the house because the family is like, no matter what protection you take, terko corona ho jayega. You know, like, and again, because we're such a greatly feminist society, घर पे ही बैठना पड़ेगा उसको, right? So, how does somebody who is pregnant, they can't go for, they're worried about going for even their sonographies. You know, कि मैं क्लिनिक जाएगा, उधर तो सब कोविड पेशेंट ही आ रहे टेस्ट लेने में. You know, to even go to my gynec. So, or OBGYN in this case. What can they do? Like, you know, it's important for a pregnant woman to have exercise and things like that. So how do you, what does she do? What in this scenario?
So I think, Navil, you know, I had an appointment with my gynecologist and I had to do all these tests that I was so skeptical about to go. But fortunately, when I had to schedule an appointment, when I walked in, they had told me that don't come into the office unless and until it's your appointment and we send you a text and then you come in to the testing room. I went there, whatever test I had to do, I did, I came out. And then I called my gynecologist and she said, you know what, you may not have to come right now. We will wait it out and I will do a telecommunication with you. You know, I'll call you and we will do a FaceTime consultancy. I think women out there who are scared, afraid to go, pick up the phone, talk to your gynecologist, explain your situation. I am sure there are ways around to do this. This is what my experience says.
Okay, so what I want to say here is a couple of people I know who are either are pregnant or are in the zone where they need to go visit the gynecs. Many of the scan centers and some of the gynecs are seeing patients who need to be seen. So, but it's not like where 40 people go and wait. They may They schedule an appointment, tell you come at 10 o'clock, come at 10:30, right. 11. So it's a very, very time conscious kind of a thing. And going for the scans and all doctors have become extremely precautionary and they are making sure that the clinics are sanitized and the instruments are sanitized and in fact they've so we are getting higher standards of
treatment,
control, and higher standards of management, and making sure that things don't. In fact, the doctors are extremely scared that they don't want to pass on this to a pregnant woman. But clearly, Neville, it's also that a new mother is extremely anxious. She's extremely concerned about the safety of her child. So she's already in an extremely anxious state. So her being worried is very, very natural, I think.
And if she's going through postpartum at this point,
If she's going through postpartum, what you can do is schedule a psychiatric consultation on video. I mean, the government has allowed that you can have a psychiatric consultation, which was not the case 3 months back. So 3 months back, a psychiatrist couldn't do an online consultation. But even today, most psychiatrists would want a first consultation face-to-face, which is a little difficult. But I'm sure that if you are going to deliver a baby in a hospital, many hospitals have visiting psychiatrists. So if they need to be called in, it can be sorted out. It's a little difficult. It's not as easy as it used to be, but it's not impossible to get.
It's impossible, correct.
ठीक है, but ये पति को कैसा समझाएगा कि मेरे को walk पे जाने का है, मेरे को actually
हाथ पकड़ के जाना पड़ेगा साथ में.
और पति को समझाएगा कैसा कि मेरे को एक psychiatrist के पास जाने का है, क्योंकि हम लोग तो एकदम ऐसा feminist galore है ना हम लोग.
No, I think postpartum depression definitely happens,
but again, it's not
such a big number. So it's about 10-12% women. So I think if a lady is going through that, I think she has to reach out. If husband is not understanding, maybe her own mother or maybe a sister-in-law or somebody who's of your generation needs to be spoken to. And
Nabil, you will be surprised. No, but you will be surprised. Most women don't even realize they are going through postpartum depression. Your gynecologist or your doctor, your GP or whomever you're going to will tell you this is what is happening to you. Most women don't realize that.
And no, even I don't realize it every time I have a food baby. Even I don't realize. I feel very sad that lovely meal has left my stomach. Okay, I'm going to quickly move on because I'm extremely conscious of time. Guys, agar thoda 10-15 minute extra lagega to please YouTube ka bill bhejta hu, YouTube ka email address bhejta hu, usko bill bhej dena. But no, this is not a YouTube thing, this is us. Also, by the way, everyone is surprised with what is postpartum. Guys, kabhi to life mein Google karo na, yahi to problem hai.
Google.
Yahi problem hai, Google karo. Abhi chodo stream, jao Google karke wapas aao, okay?
You also mentioned two other words. I think tyrophobia and imposter syndrome. People will want explanations on that.
Okay. imposter syndrome is what I have on an every single brief basis. Anything I do is not going to be great. Dunia ko pata chal jayega ki main ek hack hai. And every time I get a brief, for me, the process is, arre, mere ko idea aa gaya. Phir main uthega subah. Kya 30 idea hai? ये कौन आइडिया ऐसा कौन लिखता है, ओ शिट, दुनिया को पता चल जाएगा कि मेरे को कुछ नहीं आता है, ओ नो, मेरा टैलेंट खत्म, मेरा करियर खत्म, ओ गॉड, देयर इज नो आइडिया. देन 3 days लेटर, अच्छा ये कुछ तो अच्छा लग रहा है, ओ फाइनली, ओ अमेजिंग आइडिया. ये प्रोसेस है ऑफ एवरी सिंगल क्रिएटिव पर्सन एंड एवरी पर्सन ट्राइंग टू डू एनीथिंग दैट इज सब्जेक्टिव. सो इम्पोस्टर सिंड्रोम इज दैट. आई होप आई हैव गॉट इट राइट. ट्रायोफोबिया, व्हाटएवर दैट वर्ड इज. It's about, isn't it like having a, being really closed in it's not claustrophobia, but it's different, right? Like it's a fear of circles.
I think it's a fear of those particular patterns. Like if you see those dotted patterns, and they could be like different shapes and sizes, but those particular patterns are very close, which come very close.
Acha, haan, wo color. Are you color blind? You can't be
something like a beehive
at the same time.
Hilarious. Something like an image of a beehive or a honeycomb, things like that.
Okay, let's move on to the Ram, Sita or Gita, the Ram Lakhan of mental health. Everyone's favorite subject, anxiety and depression. Mere ko anxiety hai, mere ko depression hai. First of all, really quickly, I'm going to do this because I have 4 years of experience of being a patient. One is depression is something that it's not momentary. It's not something that is, if you're having a bad day, fucking go through it. It's fine. You can have a bad week. It's supposed to happen. It's life. Okay. But if it's impeding you, if it is coming to a point where it is affecting productivity, it is altering behavior, something that you used to do and enjoy, you can't do anymore. All of these things over an extended period of time, that is when you can consider yourself. And I think the rule of thumb is about 12 to 14 days from what I understand. I may be wrong. They will correct me if I'm
3 months. 3 to 6 weeks.
Hey, 3 months. Guys, so it's not 14 days. Huh? Sorry. 3 months. Yep. But in about 14 days, if you're feeling it, you should call a therapist and say, hey, bro, mere ko lag raha hai ki mere ko depression. Don't do it if you've had one bad day. That's just dumb. Also, anxiety is appears in many forms. There's various things that I think I'm the third most anxious person, I think, in the world. I was the most anxious person in the world. Or you know what's also gratifying is just reading all these questions. No, mere ko lag raha hai, sabko same problem hai.
Nobody's alone.
Yeah, that's the best group thing. So I think therapy. You should just talk. Yeah, you should just talk to people because sabko same problem hai. Mere ko sone ko nahi ho raha hai, mere ko creative block ho raha hai, mere ko uthne ko nahi ho raha hai, mere ko kaam karne ko nahi ho raha hai. That's pretty much every ye work from home is killing me. I'm working harder here than I used to work there. Every same question. So first of all, lack of sleep. Sleep cycles changing. The impact, the restlessness that comes with it. The impact of it and the impact of it on your own mental health, physical being, and how to cope with it. Ab ye, fortunately, I had a session with Naren yesterday. Or ho gaya wapis, 14-day extension. So, I can't, this anticipatory anxiety though is destroying my life. What is the effect that it has? Especially if you've not been diagnosed with depression or anxiety. I'm sure that everyone's levels of anxiety have gone up a little bit. My nails are over, thanks to that. So how do you deal with it? What is the impact?
So Neville, I think anxiety, all of us experience anxiety all the time. Okay, there are different levels of anxiety. Obviously, mild, moderate, severe. There are certain situations which make us more anxious. There are certain situations which we're able to cope with. Whenever we feel our coping mechanisms or our coping abilities compromise, we may really get anxious. Now, what you really need to understand is, as I was saying earlier, I think what this lockdown has done is actually thrown your entire understanding of the world on its head. In the sense, earlier people used to say, yeah, I want 5 days to just sit at home and do nothing. Well, you got 45 days to do nothing.
Can you not? It's your breaching patient confidentiality. Okay, you are you are saying...
And everybody is grumbling about, I can't go out, I can't do this, I can't do that. But whereas earlier, everybody used to grumble, arre, roj kaam pe jana padta hai, roj traffic mein mar raha hai, roj ye hai, roj wo hai. So basically, what you need to understand is that whenever something changes, we have to adapt to that situation. And that adaptation process, there's a lag when the situation occurs and by the time you adapt. So today, a lot of people have, I know for a fact that a lot of people, when this started, was, you know, gradually that they used to sleep at, say, 11:30. They started sleeping at 3:30. 15 din mein, you know, they reach 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning, and they're waking up at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. A lot of them got that back, and they pushed themselves back, and they're back to their normal track. So what you need to do is really focus on, be aware of what you're doing. Just because you don't have to go to office, it doesn't mean you cannot get up at 8 o'clock, or you don't have to wake up at 8 o'clock. That's one. I also think, Neville, that a lot of us are really struggling with this whole situation because there's also this fear of death, either red zone, either orange zone, green zone, all this is happening. So it's not just about your...
No sharab zone.
Yeah. So no alcohol, no cigarettes, no marijuana. Sorry, I'm just saying all these things. But I think a lot of people are struggling with the absence of those substances, which were normally typical escape mechanism. So you have to actually now deal with yourself and your emotions. That's becoming a big issue. So this I think is really critical.
Even when the sleep is going for a toss and you have realized your schedule is out of place and things like that, there are like 2-3 things that you can keep in mind as simple and basic as, do not drink caffeine after noon. Like, that is only going to put you up the whole night and it's not going to let you sleep. So this is a very basic thing that doesn't require any mental effort. It's just some physical effort that you have to tell yourself, please do not drink any caffeine. And Neville, I can see you drinking caffeine. Is that coffee?
No, it's chai.
Okay, and the other thing, very important thing is when this lockdown has created this whole work from home situation, You're also working at home. So it would be nice if you have like a designated workstation instead of working in bed, doing this in bed, doing everything in bed. So it's like, you get confused that what is this place for? Is this place for sleeping? Is this place for working? Or is this place for watching YouTube or Netflix? You know, so it becomes a little bit enmeshed in your head, and those, I think, guidelines need to be kept in place. So a designated workstation, somewhere to go to, even in the house, and somewhere to come back from would help. Again, Mumbai spaces are not that much, and you know, you're crammed in one house. There are some people who actually live, but they don't have their own personal space and room. Again, in that, then the boundary setting has to happen, that this is my time of working. 2 to 6, I will work. 6 to 9, you will work. You know, there can be some way of kind of figuring this out.
Yeah, सीढ़ियों पे जाके काम करो, जैसे मैं करता था ओगलवी एंड मेहता. नहीं ओगलवी नहीं, जब भी मैं इंटर्नशिप करता था बचपन में, सीढ़ियों पे जाके काम करो.
So Navil, I would like to add that you know, you should, and most of us know that anxiety stems from not having control of your environment. I mean, when we realize that we cannot control the environment, we feel very anxious.
ये तीनों मेरी ही क्यों मार रहे हैं बे? मेरे को नहीं समझ में आ रहा है यार. हाँ, okay, carry on. हाँ.
So I think you need to you know, see this in your head, think about it, and talk to yourself. You know, you mentioned about the real self and the ideal self. You have to see the real situation and the ideal situation, and figure out that there are certain things you cannot take control over, and certain things you have control over and you can control. Like Alisha said, that, you know, scheduling, sleeping habits, good eating habits, exercising, these all help. And especially there were some questions over there that, you know, I don't have medication for this time, I'm not finding medication. What are the alternatives? कि आज दवाई नहीं मिल रहा है, साइकेट्रिस्ट के पास नहीं जा पा रहा हूँ, या यू नो, यू कैन गो टू द फार्मेसी, व्हाट डू आई डू. आई थिंक कपल ऑफ थिंग्स एवरीबडी शुड कीप इन माइंड, दैट नॉट टू लूज योर स्केड्यूल. योर स्केड्यूल इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. ईटिंग वेल, आज घर पे बैठ लिया, रोज तला हुआ, अरे आज भजिया बनाओ चाय के साथ, अच्छा लगेगा. यू नो, ईट फाइन, इफ वंस इन अ व्हाइल इट्स ओके. ईटिंग वेल, योर डाइट हैज टू बी वेरी गुड. टू मच कैफीन, टू मच अल्कोहल, टू मच ड्रिंकिंग, टू मच you know, smoking. There's a lot of financial stress at this point. I mean, so much you cannot control, but you can only hope for the best. You schedule yourself. You sleep well, you eat well, you exercise. Exercise mein yoga karo, aroma therapy karo, incense jalao, bed ke sahi pe.
How does someone actually fix it? Like if you started, you know, good, and for the first week, like for the first week, I was a nervous wreck. I was finished. Like, I was like, ये तो होगा ही नहीं, चांस ही नहीं है. पहला दिन पे तो मैं जाके रोया है रात को, क्योंकि मैं कुछ 16 घंटा सिर्फ कॉल्स किए हैं. So, I think what we want to figure, I think what's important is to understand, how do you fix it now? You have 2 weeks, 2.5, 3 weeks to go. How do you fix it? Like, you've ruined your cycle. Okay, you're eating badly. How do you first step? Do you just get into bed at 11 o'clock or 10 o'clock and put your phone away, or how do you fix it?
So Neville, your cycle went from say 11:30 to 3 o'clock over a period of 15 days. So to expect that on day one I'll go back to 11 o'clock,
not happening.
So what you need to do is from 3 go to 2:30, from 2:30 go to 2, from 2 go to, you know, 12:30, and finally to 11 o'clock. So it will be a backtracking process. So every 2-3 days you backtrack by half an hour, and you'll find that your rhythm comes back to normal. So just like it went off gear over a period of time, it'll come back on track. So our
problem, why are you lying? Melatonin, bro.
Our problem is that we want to do everything right now. रुक नहीं सकता है. दिस इज द जेनरेशन विच वांट्स एवरीथिंग
इमीडिएट ग्रेटिफिकेशन.
बूमर ओपी गाइस, बूमर ओपी.
ओके, सो आई थिंक दैट्स वन पार्ट ऑफ इट. द अदर इज दैट यू नो, ऑब्वियसली योर एनवायरनमेंट कैन हेल्प यू. सो यू वांट टू स्लीप एट 11 o'clock, और तुम्हारा यू नो, योर सिस्टर और ब्रदर ब्लास्टिंग म्यूजिक ऑन द फोन, यू आर नॉट गोइंग टू बी टू स्लीप, और योर हूएवर इज देयर शेयरिंग. सो आई थिंक सो पीपल अराउंड यू डेफिनेटली नीड टू कोऑपरेट. द थर्ड थिंग इज, इफ थ्रू द डे यू आर प्रोडक्टिव, then you'll find that you'll definitely feel tired at the end of the day and you'll go to sleep. So I think it's a question of bringing it back on track over a period of time. Now, I'm seeing a lot of clients who have the other anxiety, that I've got so used to being at home, I don't think whether I'll be able to go get up at 9 o'clock and go to office. So So it's gone.
How will we readjust?
People are already talking about ke jab lockdown band hoga, how will I go back to work? I thought got used to waking up at 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
Roz subah phone karke cheekhega. Call pe. Best. But why not? Why melatonin? You don't want people to take what? Best it is, dog. You've told me twice. It's amazing melatonin. Can mean that.
Take lavender tea, chamomile tea in the night before going to bed. Have hot milk.
अरे टट्टी आएगा, I can't do all that. गरम पानी पिया टट्टी आएगा शाम को. That chance ही नहीं है. Great, amazing melatonin, dude. 5 mg. Beautiful. Guys, don't take any medication.
Don't take medication without prescriptions.
Please do not do it. It's a joke, guys. Okay, it's a joke. Okay. I want to talk about. You mentioned about medication. We've all been talking about it. There are a lot of people now who are on very heavy to very mild drugs for that have been prescribed by their psychiatrist. They aren't able to fulfill their prescriptions. They aren't able to refill them. Alternate medication as a result is also a problem. I mean, I'm assuming the psychiatrist and the therapist obviously will help them. But is there anything that, I mean, is all medication trying to figure out how to get serotonin into your brain? Is that what it is?
No, I just want to correct over here, Nevin. I think...
Of course, please.
No. I think a lot of these clients, probably some of these people don't know that they can reach out to their doctors, send them a message. And if they are regular prescriptions they have, they can be refilled. They can prescribe online. And the chemists are definitely
delivering it.
So one thing is that don't be under this impression that you cannot get your medication. One. Yeah. The other part is, if you are for the first time you're going, definitely the psychiatrist would like to have an interview with you. So there are some hospitals which are operational. The only thing is of getting there and making sure or how to get there. So maybe if it's close by in your vicinity, maybe it's a possibility. Otherwise, you have to wait out this period. That's what I would like to say.
Yeah, doing some research and keeping like resources handy would always help. Like, you know, you live in Goregaon, say, for example, keep all the Goregaon psychiatrists handy. Like, even though when your psychiatrist is unavailable, say, for example, this medication is something you urgently need, you should have some resources that you can kind of go and talk to. Or even your therapist who can guide you what can be done. Again, like Narendra sir said, there are hospitals which are open 24/7. Again, there is a risk that people are scared going to the hospital. But I think maintaining the precaution and the safety, that can be another option as well.
Someone mentioned on the chat, and I want to just clear it up. The reason why we're not talking about really serious things like bipolar disorder, schizophrenia and stuff is because those things are already clinically diagnosed. Most people who have them have great support systems. Families know how to deal with it. Of course, it's difficult right now. But I wanted to keep this chat slightly more relevant and relatable to a lot of people. And that's why. So guys, obviously, there are many other things that we've not spoken about. And we've also brushed it. But you need to think. I want to move on to two things, guys. We're really running out of time. You guys mind staying around for like 10, 15 minutes more, please?
Yeah. Sure. Okay, thank you. Yeah, no problem.
Okay. Really quickly. How do you... and let's Arnab it, which is one person answer. And then I will say, shut up. Only I'm talking. Let's talk about a lot of people are now increasingly getting self-doubt, negative thoughts, overthinking. Or as Naren calls it, it's not overthinking if you spend time with yourself. It is not overthinking, it is thinking. As Baba Naren says to me, it is not overthinking, but it's new for people. It's new for people who are 24/7 with people or with their phones and things like that. Negative thoughts are increasing. They're constantly on loop. They're increasing anxiety. I think also the word here, making me anxious, is being used very loosely. It's being used in the traditional and not the medical sense of the word. How do you tackle that? Self-doubt obviously creeps in. I get this question every Sunday. I just want to... self-doubt, overthinking, negative thoughts, loneliness, increase in suicidal thoughts. Why is it happening, and how do we deal with this?
I think due to this lockdown, you know, there is a lot of fear of future and uncertainty you know, be it jobs, be it personal lives, I can't date somebody, or I'm having a long distance relationship. Again, I would emphasize that this is not permanent. Let's use this time to be extremely positive, be purposeful, you know, use this time to visualize and create the future. Think about, you know, a lot of people will come up with this fear that अरे आज मेरा ये काम कर रहा था अभी ये आगे चल के नहीं होने वाला ये वायरस की वजह से I have to stop my business or whatever. Use this time to have creative thoughts about what can I do in the midst of the coronavirus or the COVID-19 situation that I can build myself. So instead of having the self-doubt and negative thought, push yourself to the positive part of your life, as to stay informed in right ways. Look up sites where you can find that you can do some online courses. Learn a new language. I mean, do things that will help you, equip you. That ye jab khatam ho jayega, how will you tread ahead?
ये आई मीन ये ऑनेस्टली इतना एक्साइटिंग कॉन्वर्सेशन है बट नहीं होता है when you are in a system of this constant loop of failure of आगे जाके क्या होगा how do you get out of it? Like, it's obviously there's no one pill, there's no one solution to it. And yes, you can get these minimal moments where you can try and, you know, positivize a situation and things like that. But how do you convince yourself? Like, depression, suicidal thoughts are increasing, especially for people who live alone, introverts. How do we make that go away? When you're overthinking, how do you say, do you make a list? Do you do pros and cons? Like, is there that sort of...
I would like to answer this, Neville. Neville, in psychology, we have a concept of learned helplessness. So just like we learn a lot of things, we learn helplessness. Okay, now what is this? No, I mean, why are you holding your head?
Because I know where this is going.
No. I mean it in a very, very positive sense. What I want to say here is, so you because of a lot of things have not gone the way you wanted them, or the way you desired, we start feeling that we are utter failure, or we are total failures, or we are not people who can cope up with these situations. But at the same time, while a lot of things were going wrong in your life, some things were going right in your life. What our brain tends to do is it tends to highlight the failures and it tends to downplay the successes. So what you need, this is a trick your own brain is playing on you. Now, if you learn to analyze and you learn to pay attention to your own brain, people call it the monkey brain. Okay, so the brain is actually playing these tricks on you and making a monkey out of you, right? Now, if you really, really start paying attention,
Alisha is laughing because usko TYBA ka paper yaad aa gaya usko.
Definition yaad aa
gaya. You really need to focus on that. Why am I feeling this? Because certain things went wrong, but then there were a few good things which have happened. And you have kind of downplayed them. And I can give you a very practical example with a client. The other day she said, I don't know what to do. I said, what do you like? She said, I like cooking. So I said, can you start cooking 7 things in 7 days? And she did it. And on the 8th day...
You just changed the gender and made it about me again.
No. And she said, I started feeling good. No, this is genuine. So the point is that when people do the things, so rather than focusing on what's going in my head, you need to do with what I can do with my life. So it has to move from thought to action.
Action.
I understand that it's a difficult process. When
it's a vicious cycle. It is a vicious cycle.
But the very fact that you push yourself up the bed, your brain sends a message to itself, okay, this guy is, you know, not going to be a monkey anymore.
Yeah. It's also... what he's saying is correct. It's also called behavioral activation. Like, to change your thought, you're first changing your action, which is going on to changing your feeling and changing your thought at the end of the day.
The reverse
cycle. Yeah, it's a part of CBT.
Okay. I want to quickly, I have literally, we have 10-15 minutes. Everybody who's watching, at the end of this, I'm going to project numbers and keep those numbers up for about 3-4 minutes before I shut the live. I'm going to project numbers for Talk To Me, which is an NGO. You can call and book your appointments and have an open conversation with someone judgment-free. You can figure out what's convenient time, etc., etc. There are several other NGOs out there. This is not the only NGO. I know about this one, and I know about it because of Naren, because Naren's NGO. But I want to make sure that to know that there are other NGOs out there that do the same thing. You need to figure out which ones you want to work with. I'm going to project Talk To Me's numbers at the end of this. In about 5-10 minutes, we should be wrapping up. Let's go into an ad break in the meantime. Kidding. I feel like those guys. A lot of people have worry about their job, the economy, whether they're going to graduate, when they graduate and they're coming into the workforce. How do you tackle? I mean, you can't. We're not economists, and we're not people who have. What do you do about, like, if you are going to lose your job? A, it's anticipatory. B, if you already have, how do you cope with it? Because you have responsibilities, you have things like that. What is there? I mean, it's horrible. So how do you do that?
I'm definitely really far from being a financial analyst. I can't deal with numbers at all. But the basic thing to keep in mind, I think right now in the lockdown situation, would be kind of pre-plan. You can kind of check your finances. How much do you have right now? For how many months it's going to last? Some realistic perspective on, okay, where am I in the whole financial situation? I think that would kind of give a realistic perspective on, okay, this much is what I have. I need to acknowledge that it's not as bad as I'm thinking right now. But if it is really bad, there are maybe if someone can support you, maybe a friend or a relative, you can kind of reach out to them and ask them for help. That, okay, this is a monetary crisis for me. Can you please help me out with this?
It is a fair anxiety, though.
It's a fair anxiety.
It's a disruptive phase in our lives. So, for example, every 20 years, some new technology will come which will disrupt the way the world functions. And right now, it's not technology, it's a virus. So it's a disruptive phase in our life for which we have to obviously cope and ultimately come to new terms. So certain jobs will be lost, but certain new jobs will be created. Because, for example, I give you an example of cleaning of, so clinics and all will probably focus more on health, or masks will be there, or there will be so many other new industries which may come up. So we all need to look for as to what will really work in the new world that we are moving into. And maybe people will become more conscious about how they spend their time and how they spend their money and how they live their lives.
This COVID situation is something we definitely can't control, but a situation like basing your financial decisions on your emotions or in a panic or in a frenzy, these are the things that definitely we can control.
I think sometimes it's also okay to understand and tell yourself that, you know, I'm sorry to myself and say that, you know, I'm sorry I'm in this situation, and I'm sorry that it's not my fault. And whatever the situation is, I can't do anything about it. But to reevaluate the situation.
I've made them believe that it's everybody else's fault.
So I think to add to what Naren has said, that, you know, we need to rethink moving forward as to what is going to help us build our career. You know, maybe some industries may not work, but some other industries, this is the time to equip yourself with those skills and reaching out, like Alisa said, that to reach out and, you know, acknowledge that, you know, you are in a tough time. It will help you cope with it better.
Never okay. On a lighter note, I want to say that therapists will definitely work out.
Yeah, I know that. There are only two people who will make money, no? Therapists and wedding planners. No matter what the situation is, and funeral people. Ye to teen to jaane wala hi nahi na life. Okay, so I want to quickly head back and close with two questions. One is, I want to talk about dependence and forced dependence, where, Alisha, you touched upon it, where parents make you feel guilty in a time like this. And there are some toxic parents out there. They make you feel guilty. There's someone who's written a question about how they're the sole breadwinner of the family and currently aren't going to work. And so the parents are troubling him or her. To a point where they're like, your money is going to get over this, that, and the other. And so this forced dependence, because the father lost the job, this forced dependence, or we did this for you, you did this for us. And you also have to have the means and the ability to do it. If you're 19, not everyone's me who can start working at 19, you know. I'm just saying, like, how do you deal with a forced dependence situation? And, you know, earlier we touched upon it saying that you have to be able to talk to your parents, but parents don't listen. Parents don't listen. And just to say ki, nahin, this is what I think. तुम जाओ बाहर में चांस ही नहीं ना घर से निकल देगा कुछ माँ बाप तो ये सिचुएशन में भी घर से निकल देगा मतलब सो आई जस्ट हाउ डू यू डील विद फोर्स्ड डिपेंडेंस इफ यू आर द सोल ब्रेड ओनर इतना टफ क्वेश्चन वाओ
वेल टू लाइटन इट अप आई जस्ट सक इट अप नो
सॉरी करेक्ट
It's very unfortunate and very sorry to hear that, you know, parents are forcing kids or their children to feel like that. Again, a lot of things have to come into check boxes where things I can do and things I cannot do. Accepting it yourself, I think, will help it. You cannot fight with your parents. You cannot change your parents. You can disengage from what they have to say and do what is right for yourself. I mean, do what is right for you. They are not going to be there forever. So now whatever is there. No, I am telling you, this is suck
That's
it
the
up.
Hard
I mean,
to hear.
That is hard. It is hard. It is hard. But it's the hard
I think it's hilarious for. Because if you're in the point of, this is why I'm a dark comic, because in my head, that kid, who is suffering from this, is like, tum mar kyun nahi jate? Like, it's literally that.
It's the only coping strategy at this point when you have to live with everybody. Can you think about it? Like, you have to.
Yeah.
So, Neville, what do you think, I want to ask you, what do you think a kid can do in such a situation?
My answer is the same.
Ball has been thrown to Neville.
No, my answer is the same. काम तो काम है यार वो तो करना ही पड़ेगा ना झक मरेंगे मतलब दिस इज माय कांस्टेंट आर्गुमेंट विद यू एंड देन योर थ्रोबैक टू मी इज बट एट व्हाट पॉइंट इज इट गोइंग टू स्टॉप बीइंग वर्क फॉर यू राइट बट द पॉइंट इज काम तो काम है दैट्स नॉट गोइंग टू स्टॉप आई मीन टू मी इट्स ऑल्सो वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू कॉम्प्रीहेंड दैट अ पेरेंट कैन डू दिस for me, it's very difficult because I didn't have that, and I'm terribly sorry when some people have to face this problem. But I mean, to me, I think the situation is just put your head down, work doubly hard during this time.
So I want to say,
of course here, not. Maja out me only. Why you entrapped me then?
Now that I heard your answer,
no.
A lot of us don't look at our parents as human beings, people who can make mistakes. People who can go wrong and people who have their own chinks and flaws. We look at them as these demigods who are supposed to know everything and are supposed to be perfect. So yes, parents like you. So you were a kid and you messed up their lives. You've grown up a bit. Now they're messing up your life. It's payback time. Maybe. That's one way to look at it. I know you're
he's
joking.
He's just saying the same thing I said, the suck it up.
No, so Neville, you're choking on it. I know. The point. No, I mean it. I mean it in the sense that you also need to understand that people today have very limited tolerance. They feel as if the world owes them everything. Well, your parents don't. You owe them. Maybe it's time to just shut up and deal with it.
Maybe you can
also have a conversation in which you can address that these expectations that you're having from me are kind of unrealistic at this point. Like it can't be like I have to work doubly like a donkey and then figure it out. Just basically you're giving me an option to figure it out. So how are you going to figure this out? There's no realistic plan created for that. What you can do is sit down with your family if they are able to listen to you, obviously. Sit down, make a plan, who's going to contribute what. And that could at least be a conversation starter on, okay, fine, this is your responsibility. This is mine and we are going to share it. It but can't be like you're putting the whole burden on me.
It's not easy life. Life is tough.
It is not easy. Grow up. Life is tough, yeah.
Not easy.
Tum log start mein kitna sweet tha. Yehi problem hai tum log ka. As a community, tumhari therapist log ki calm na. Char session ke baad aise ho jate ho tum log sab.
I think it's been a
really grateful session. Everyone in the chat, just say OP to everyone. When I look here, I'm actually talking to the people in the chat. It's not thing. I know technically I should be looking here and saying chat people do this, but no, I'm going to do it this way. The other thing I want to say, thank you so much. I think I know we're running. We've gone way past that time. Anything in the end that you want to say? I'm going to project numbers as soon as we say bye. Thank you so much. Anything that you want to, any tips? Like if you had to give like everybody had to give 5 things to do and 5 different things. Don't try to overlap them. 5 different things.
Oh, that's going to be tough. 5 different things.
Five will be taken off the table. Think about it.
I'm giving you my 5.
Go. Take. Cheat. Don't thopo on me only. Come on. Five things. 5 things that people can do right now.
I'm going to use your theory. Look at the sky for 10 minutes every day. I think it works wonderfully. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of exercise, a lot of time. Be very grateful for what you have right now. Find happiness in little things.
Too positive. Huh?
Yeah, and eat well.
Eat well. Okay, I do eat well only. Huh? Okay, let's go. Alisha, Doc, wait now, Naren, I'm coming to you. Last me, I will budget.
Yeah. I give
after
3.
After me, you will go.
Can I give 3?
Give three.
First and foremost, when you were talking about the self-worth.
See, anyway,
part,
the differential, women are paid 22% less, right? So you give 3.
I'm going to give 3 because 3 are on the top of my head.
Correct.
So when you're talking about the self-worth part, this is something I wanted to address even then. It's important to think about where you're basing your self-worth on. Is it that I'm going to be productive, matlab I'm a good person? Is it that I have to work for 8 hours, matlab I am a definitely efficient person? Like your self-worth doesn't come from these external things. It's like a self thing. So that needs to be kind of reminded. Again, the first pointer will be being kind to yourself. It's a different situation. It's an uncertain situation. Just be kind to yourself and others. Be connected. Be socially connected. We are social animals. We like talking. We like connecting. Just keep the connection going. And the last thing is routine. As much as you can, please try and make a routine.
Okay. No. I go.
Never.
Then you go. Okay, so for me, I think make lists. I think the lists really, really help. They've genuinely made me feel better. The first week, I was terrible. I was in tears regularly. I'm thinking about it also and getting slightly teary. The lists really help. Put dumb shit on it. Put really dumb shit on it. Brush your teeth also. Put it okay if you don't have anything else. The second thing you need to put, the second thing I would do is do what you enjoy doing. But do it in limited quantities. Don't go so crazy over it. Like I like cooking. Main pehla 3 hafte mein 4 meal banata tha. Aur wo bhi aisa chawal dal mast ekdam. Okay, don't do that. It's pointless because you'll start hating what you love doing. So do it in limited quantities. But do it once a day. Do it twice a day. But make sure that you don't get exhausted doing it. That's another thing that I want to say. The third thing I want to say. That would genuinely help people is it's not just about routine. I would also say cut off from the thing that you're doing at that point. So supposing if you've come to lunch, don't do work, during lunch. Don't make everything a working lunch. Make sure that you're able to disconnect for that 25, 30 minutes that you're giving yourself, fully disconnect from it. And then give yourself time for the rest of the time. I know what Kinga is thinking also right now. I know his next comment the minute I go to him is going to be, I know what it's going to be also. And then the final thing, and the final thing is, I would say the shows and movies and anything that you wanted to watch or do, sort of make it last. Don't binge watch all 21 seasons of OC. You know, just don't. I know the sentence. I'm saying make it last. Because when you do that, you know that you have something to look forward to, and that sort of gives you happiness. So make it last. But that also doesn't mean save it forever. Like COVID also gets over, you also get over, everybody dies, and you've still not done it. Yeah. So just space it out. Those are my 5 tips. Yes, Doc, you can start with Neville. Isme se tu do bhi karega, to bhi acha rahega tere liye.
Neville, I feel happy that some of the things I've said have actually registered. And at least they're in the head, though they may not be out there in the real world.
No, he's doing it.
One last thing. Gratitude list. At the end of the day, talk to somebody who you are, who you love, who you like, who you're friends with, or parents, or anybody, another person. And if you don't have that person who you want to confide in, do it yourself, but physically actually write it down on your phone or on a piece of paper, which is 3 things that you are super grateful for that day. 3 things. It could be anything. It could be khana acha bana. It could be anda aaj phuta nahi.
Say thank you and sorries.
Yeah. Well, isme se main ek hi cheez karta hai, wo list hai, kyunki kaam karna padta hai. Chalo. Haan.
So, great. I think all of them have actually covered a lot, but I think I would like to highlight sleep, the importance of sleep, and making sure that you have a good sleep cycle and a good sleep structure. That's very, very important. I also feel that, we were so caught up in our routines that many of us did not do something out of our routines. So actually, this is a time when maybe you can do one thing out of your routine. So, for example, somebody who likes cooking didn't cook, maybe you can start doing that. So do one thing. So it could be 7 different things on 7 different days. So on a Sunday, you do something. On a Monday, you do something. So every day you're doing something. So you're feeling little charged. The third is, I think I want to highlight that if you feel lonely, if you feel down and out, if you feel anxious, if you feel nervous, please reach out to either a therapist or a friend or a family member. Definitely don't feel that nobody gives a damn for me and I'm all in this all alone.
We're all in this together.
Fourth, I think we all need to plan for our future. It's a default future in the sense we don't know what the future is going to be, but you can have a visualization of a default future that I will do this and I will not do that, or this is what I think has been my realization in these periods. And fifth, I think maybe spend more time with your loved ones, which is family, friends, etc. I think that will, this is something which I am speaking for Bombay. I think we actually do end up neglecting our family. We do end up not really spending enough time. And this is a great opportunity to do that. So so earlier you would hang out with your friends, learn to hang out with your family. I think that's a great way to take.
Okay. There's just one thing I want to say. I missed out one section about relationships. A lot of people are saying that their relationships are suffering. Either they're going down the drain or they're it's too overwhelming. If I say something incorrectly, just correct me, which is that the way I think you should do it is have the ability to have a conversation and say that we need time apart. Stay apart for a bit. And by that, I don't mean don't talk to each other. Like, do your thing, let the other person do their thing. Meet for meals, sort a date night if you can, what you did outside. And for that date night, dress up, actually dress up, and eat a meal at home. If you have that, if you don't, you can still do the same thing over FaceTime. They don't know what pants you're not wearing unless and until it's going somewhere else. But the point is, I think to keep the relationship healthy, I think conversation, space, and giving the other person just that amount of space is extremely important, and doing things on your own. If I have to, if somebody has to add anything else, please do.
Can I add something?
It cannot be positive. You have to say something negative.
Neville, I think what most couples don't do is, like you rightly pointed out, communicate and listen. I think that is very important. And, you know, sometimes it's nice to ask your significant other, how are you doing today? This is as simple as that. Will make you
sweet or positive
with
advice.
Your...
Unhappy.
I think also the factor that you know that the situation is uncertain, you can't make concrete plans, but you can make plans in the air, which will float.
Alicia, kya
and
plan
one
hai, bro?
fine day, you can definitely do it, because that will still get you like feel eager.
Yeah.
True.
So
oh God, Alicia got disconnected by the person who her significant other is.
So Neville, I want to just say one thing. I think how we were on this webinar, where we were waiting for the other person to say something, and then we were responding, and you know, everybody else was listening on, then we were taking off from each other. Mm-hmm. I think our relationships have required that kind of, it requires that kind of bonding and
understanding.
You're basically, I think, listening to the other person before you spout your wisdom. So I think very, very simply put, I would like to say that, you listen more than you talk. I think that's very, very important.
Listen more than you talk. Great advice. Alicia, were you trying to send signals to someone and they cut you off?
Oh, the session got extended by so many minutes. My laptop drained out and I had to switch to my phone.
Okay. And I think one great sentence is, don't make concrete plans. If you want to break up, just wait. If you want to fall in love, just wait. If you want to propose marriage, also wait. Just don't. If you want to quit your job, wait. Don't do anything big right now. Huge tumultuous times. Okay, thank you so much. You guys are amazing. Genuinely, everybody who's watching and everybody who's here on the panel, really, 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 I really appreciate this. Thank you so much. I'm going
Neville,
to project the number now.
I want to add something on behalf of my colleagues to you, that thank you so much for hosting this. Thank you for reaching out to so many people. I mean, it was a burden taken on your little shoulders, and you did it all alone, but you did it incredibly well. Thank you for this. This was an opportunity for us to reach out. This was an opportunity that you gave us to reach out to other people. We are very, very grateful. Thank you so much.
I can't handle compliments. I don't take compliments well. Imposter syndrome, bro. So
Neville, I'm not saying anything because she said it all, so I'm going to keep quiet.
Yeah, I just want to say thank you for having us and hope this helps.
Yeah, it will help. And if you guys don't charge, we'll see you. We'll try to do this once a month if people really like it. But
definitely.
Thank you so much. Thank you. You guys can
thank
exit
you.
The meeting. I am going to project the numbers now. You guys are amazing. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
All right. Thank you so much, everyone who's been watching this. These are the numbers. I'm going to hold this up for another 5-6 minutes. You guys should have these numbers. Please take them down. Feel free to talk to whoever you need to talk to. The intention here is to make sure that everybody gets them. And yeah. I'm going to hold these numbers for a bit. You guys want me to do jokes or what? If you all want me to do jokes, then just say Jokopi. I don't know. I don't do this. I don't know how to do this. This is the first time I've done a stream. I really want to thank you guys. You guys have genuinely been here for the whole time. Thank you. I'm stop my video now. Yes, I will be uploading this full on. I will be uploading this, the entire episode. What I'm also going to be doing is I'm going to chop up chunks of it as in when I have the procrastinated my bandwidth to do this. And I will put the, I will put up the smaller clips on the channel and other social media places. These are the Talk to Me numbers. And I'm going to now go. Bye, guys.